Awaking in the middle of a tough snore and sitting up in bed to gather his thoughts, Scrooge knew the bell was again upon the stroke of one. He turned uncomfortably cold when he began to wonder which of his curtains this new spirit would choose. Prepared for almost anything when the bell struck one and no shape appeared, he was afraid. 5 minutes, 10 minutes, a quarter of an hour went by, yet nothing came. He began to think that the source and the secret of this ghostly light might be in the next room. He got up softly and shuffled in his slippers to the door. That moment, a strange voice called him by his name and told him to enter. He obeyed. It was his own room. There's no doubt about that, but it had undergone a surprising transformation. The walls and ceilings were hung with living green that it looked like a garden. Crisp leaves of holly, mistletoe, and ivy reflected back the light.
And there, heaped up on the floor to form a kind of a throne, there were turkeys, there were geese, there were poultry, meat, mince pies, plum, pudding, barrels of oysters, red-hot chestnuts, cherry-cheeked apples, juicy oranges, luscious pears, and in an easy state upon this couch, there sat a jolly green giant, glorious to see, who bore a glowing torch to shed its light on Scrooge as he came peeping around the door.
Come in. Come in. And know me better, man.
Scrooge entered timidly and hung his head before this spirit, and though the spirit's eyes were clear and kind, he did not like to meet them.
I am the ghost of Christmas present. Look upon me.
Scrooge reverently did so. The spirit was clothed in one simple green robe bordered with white fur.
You have never seen the like of me before.
Never.
Never walked forth with the younger members of my family.
I don't think I have. Have you had many brothers, Spirit?
More than 1,800.
A tremendous family to provide for. Tonight, if you have to teach me, let me profit by it.
Touch my robe.
Scrooge did as he told and held it fast. Holly, mistletoe, red berries, ivy, turkeys, geese, sausages, pies, puddings, and punch all vanished instantly. So did the room, the fire, and they stood in the streets on Christmas morning where the people, in scraping the snow from the pavement in front of their dwellings and from the tops of their houses. The grocers nearly closed. Christmas Eve, with perhaps two shutters down, was not alone that the registers on the counter made the merry so sound, or that the blended scents of tea and coffee were so grateful to the nose, or even the raisins were so plentiful, the almonds so extremely white, the sticks of cinnamon so long and straight, the other spices so delicious, the candied fruits so caked and spotted with sugar. The customers were all eager in their hopeful promise of the day that they tumbled upon each other at the door, crashing their wicker baskets wildly, and left their purchases upon down before him, and his clothes ironed and brushed to look seasonable, Tiny Tim upon his shoulder. For Tiny Tim bore a little crutch and had his legs supported by an iron frame.
And how did that little Tim behave?
As good as gold and better. He told me coming home that he hoped that people saw him in the church because he was a cripple, and it might be pleasant to them to remember Christmas Day.
Spirit, tell me if Tiny Tim will live.
I see a vacant seat in the corner and a crutch without an owner. If these shadows remain unaltered by the future, the child will die.
No, no, oh no, kind spirit, say he will be spared.
If these shadows remain unaltered by the future, none will find him here. What then if he be like to die? He had better do it and decrease the surplus population.
Merry Christmas.
God bless us, everyone.
Tiny Tim sat very close to his father's side upon his little stool. Bob held his little withered hand in his. Because of his love for the child, he wished to keep him by his side and dreaded that he might be taken from him. Mr. Scrooge, I'll give you Mr. Scrooge, the founder of the feast.
The founder of the feast, indeed. I wish I had him here. I'll give him a piece of my mind to feast upon, and hope he had a good appetite for it.
My dear, the children, Christmas Day.
It should be Christmas Day, I'm sure, when one drinks to the health of such a stingy, hard man as Mr. Scrooge. You know he is, Robert. Nobody knows it better than you do.
My dear, the children, Christmas Day.
I'll drink his health for your sake and the day's, not for his. Long life to him. A Merry Christmas and Happy New Year. He'll be very merry and very happy.
They drank the toast after her. Tiny Tim drank it last of all, but he didn't care for it. Scrooge was the ogre of the family. The mention of his name cast a dark shadow on the party, which held the room for 5 full minutes. And now, without a word of warning from the ghost, they stood upon a bleak mass of stone, as though it were the burial place of the giants. And water spread itself wheresoever it wanted, and nothing grew but moss.
My life upon this globe is very brief. It ends tonight. Tonight at midnight, the time is drawing near.
A light shone from the window of a hut. It was a great surprise to Scrooge to hear a hearty laugh. It was a much greater surprise to Scrooge to recognize it as his own nephew's, and to find himself in a bright, dry, gleaming room with the spirit standing smiling by his side and looking at the same nephew approvingly.
Ha 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 ha. He said that Christmas was a humbug, as I live. He believed it too.
More shame for him, Fred.
He's a comical old fellow, that's the truth, and not so pleasant as he might be. However, his offenses carry their own punishment, and I have nothing to say against him.
I'm sure he is very rich, Fred. At least you tell me so.
What, my dear? His wealth's no use to him. He don't do any good with it. He don't make himself comfortable with it. He hasn't the satisfaction of thinking that he is ever going to benefit us with it.
I have no patience for him.
Oh, I have. I am sorry for him and couldn't be angry with him if I tried. Who suffers by his attitude? Himself. Always.
Indeed. I think he loses a very good day.
After tea, they had some music. All the things that the ghost had shown Scrooge came to his mind. He softened more and more. The ghost was greatly pleased to find him in this mood and looked upon him with such favor that Scrooge begged like a boy to be allowed to stay. But this, the spirit said, could not be done.
Here is a game. 1/2 hour. Spirit, only one.
It was a game called Yes and No, where Scrooge's nephew had to think of something and the rest must find out what, only answering to their questions yes or no. The round of questions to which he was exposed elicited from him that he was thinking of an animal, a live animal, rather a disagreeable animal, a savage animal, an animal that growled and grunted sometimes, and talked sometimes, and lived in London.
It walked about the streets and wasn't made a show of and wasn't led by anybody.
Was not a horse, a cow, a bull, a tiger, or a dog, or a pig, or a cat, or a bear. At every fresh question that was put to him, this nephew burst into a fresh roar of laughter and was so inexpressibly tickled that he was obliged to get up off the sofa and jump. At last, the plump sister, falling into a similar state, cried out,
"We have found it out! I know what it is, Fred! I know what it is!"
What is it?
It's your Uncle Scrooge.
He has given us plenty of laughter, I am sure, and it would be ungrateful not to drink his health. Here is a glass of wine ready to the moment, and I say, Uncle Scrooge.
Uncle Scrooge.
A Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year to the old man, whatever he is. He wouldn't take it from me, but may he have it, nevertheless.
Uncle Scrooge had become so happy and light of heart that he would have thanked them in speech if the ghost had given him time. But the whole scene passed off in the breath of the last words spoken by his nephew, and he and the spirit were again upon their travel. Scrooge looked about him for the ghost and saw it not.
The chimes were ringing at that moment. The bell struck 12.
Tonight at midnight, the time is drawing near.
As the last stroke ceased to vibrate, he remembered the prediction of old Jacob Marley, and lifting up his eyes, he beheld a phantom coming along the ground towards him. The phantom slowly, silently approached. It was shrouded in a deep black garment, which concealed its head, its face,
its form and left nothing of it visible but one outstretched hand.
I am in the presence of the ghost of Christmas yet to come. You are about to show me shadows of the things that have not happened, but will happen in time before us. Is that so, spirit? Ghost of the future, I fear you more than any ghost I have seen, but I know you, your purpose, and as I hope to live, to be another man from what I was, I am prepared to bear your company and do it with thankful heart. Will you not speak to me? Lead on, lead on.
The ghost conducted him and they entered poor Bob Cratchit's house, the dwelling he had visited before, and found the mother and the children seated around the fire. Quiet, the noisy little Cratchits were still as statues. In one corner, and they sat looking up at Peter, who had a book before him. The mothers and her daughters were engaged in sewing, but they were very quiet.
The color hurts my eyes. They're better now again. It makes them weak by candlelight, and I wouldn't show weak eyes to your father when he comes home.
It is past rather, but I think he has walked a little slower than he used these few late evenings, Mother.
I have known him to walk with Tiny Tim upon his shoulder, very fast indeed. But he was very light to carry, and his father loved him so. There's your father at the door.
She hurried out to meet him, and little Bob in his comforter came in, and his tea was ready for him, and they all tried who should help him to it the most. Bob was very cheerful with them and spoke pleasantly to all the family. He looked at the work on the table and praised the industry and speed of Mrs. Cratchit and the girl. They would be done long before Sunday, he said.
Sunday? You went today, then Robert?
He broke down all at once. He couldn't help it. He left the room and went upstairs in the room above, which was lighted cheerfully and hung with Christmas. Just a little down, you know. But know that when we are apart from another, I'm sure none of us will forget Tiny Tim.
Never, Father.
And I know we remember how patient he was. Although he was a little child, we shall not fight easily among ourselves. And never forget Tiny Tim in doing it.
No, never, Father.
I am very happy. I am very happy. The spirit stopped. The hand was pointed elsewhere. The spirit stood among the graves and pointed down to one. He advanced towards it.
Before I go near to that stone, answer me one question. Are these the shadows of things that will be, or are they the shadows of things that may be only?
Ebenezer crept towards it, trembling as he went, and following the finger, he read upon the stone of the neglected grave his own name.
Ebenezer Scrooge.
Am I that man who lay dead? No, spirit. Oh, no, no. Spirit, hear me. I am not the man I was. I will not be the man I must have been. Your nature intercedes for me and pities me. Assure me I yet may change these shadows you have shown me. I will honor Christmas in my heart and try to keep it all the year. I will live it in the past, the present, and the future. The spirits of all three shall strive within me. I will not shut out the lessons that they teach.
Yes! And the bedpost was his own, and the bed was his own, the room was his own. Best and happiest of all, the time before him was his own to make amends.
I will live in the past, the present, and the future.
He was so fluttered and so glowing with his good intentions that his face was aglow.
I don't know what to do. I am as light as a feather. I am as happy as an angel, as merry as a schoolboy. I am as giddy as a drunken man. A Merry Christmas to everybody. A Happy New Year to all the world. Hello here. Whoop. Hello.
He had whisked into the sitting room and was now standing there perfectly tired.
There's the door. where the ghost of Jacob Marley entered. There's a corner where the ghost of Christmas present sat.
Running to the window, he opened it and put out his head. No fog, no mist. Clear, bright, jovial, stirring, cold, golden, sunlight, heavenly sky, sweet, fresh air, merry bells.
Oh, glorious, glorious, what's today?
Eh? Today, why Christmas Day?
My fine fellow.
Calling downward to a boy in Sunday clothes, who perhaps had loitered in to look about.
Hello.
It's Christmas Day. I haven't missed it. The spirits have done it all in one night. They can do anything they like. Of course they can. Of course they can. Hello, my fine fellow. Do you know the store in the next street at the corner?
I sure hope I do.
An intelligent boy, a remarkable boy. Do you know whether they've sold the prize turkey that was hanging up there? Not the little prize turkey, the big one.
What, the one as big as me?
Not the little prize turkey, the big one.
It's hanging there now.
Is it? Go and buy it.
No way.
No, no. I am earnest. Go to buy it.
The boy was off like a shot.
He won't know who sends it. It's twice the size of Tiny Tim.
He wrote the address and went downstairs to open the street door, ready for the coming of the delivery man.
Here's the turkey. Hello. Whoop.
The turkey was so big, could have never stood upon its legs, that bird.
Who are you? Merry Christmas. Why, it's impossible to carry that to Camden Town. You must have a cab.
With which he said this, and the chuckle with which he paid for the turkey, and the chuckle which he had paid for the cab, and the chuckle which he had recompensed the boy, were only to be exceeded by the chuckle with which he sat down breathless in his chair again, and he chuckled until he cried. He dressed himself all his best, and at last got into the streets. The people were this time pouring forth. Scrooge regarded everyone with a delighted smile. He looked so irresistibly pleasant, in a word, that three or four good-humored fellows said, "Good morning, sir, and a Merry Christmas to you."
My dear sir, how do you do? I hope to succeed yesterday. It was very kind of you. A Merry Christmas to you, sir.
Mr. Scrooge,
coming towards him, beheld the portly gentleman who walked into his counting house the day before and said, "Scrooge and Marley's, I believe." Pain shot across his heart to think how this old gentleman would look at him when they met, quickening his pace and taking the old gentleman by both hands.
Lord bless you. My dear Mr. Scrooge, are you serious?
If you please, not a dollar left. A great many back payment are included in it.
Oh, my dear sir, I don't know what to say to much generosity.
Don't say anything. Please come and see me. Will you come and see me?
We will.
Scrooge was early at the office next morning. Oh, he was there early. If only he could be there first and to catch Bob Cratchit coming late. The clock struck 9, no Bob. A quarter past, no Bob. He was a full 18 minutes behind his time. Scrooge sat with his door wide open that he might see him come into the tank.
Hello! What do you mean by coming here at this time of day?
I'm very sorry, sir. I am behind my time.
You are, yes. Step this way, sir, if you please.
But it's only once a year, sir. It shall not be repeated. I was making rather merry yesterday, sir.
Now, I'll tell you what, my friend. I am not going to stand this sort of thing no longer.
Bob trembled and got a little nearer to the ruler. He had a momentary idea of knocking Scrooge down with it, holding him, and calling for the people in the court to help him.
And therefore, I'm about to raise your salary.
Scrooge was better than his word. He did it all, and infinitely more. And to Tiny Tim, who did not die, he was a second father. He became as good a friend, as good a boss, and as good a man, as good old city knew. in the good old world. Some people laughed to see the change in him, but he let them laugh. He had no further run-in with the spirits, but lived upon the total abstinence principle ever afterwards, and it was always said of him that he knew how to keep Christmas well. And so, as Tiny Tim observed, God bless us, everyone.